Yeah, thank you again for coming again. The good news is that this talk I want to give today is rather independent of the talk before. Of course, I will recall some of the things. The point will be that it's like when you make computation with singular homology. You learn the definition, but then you can forget it. This is a good point here. But let me at least review what Haddad did last time very quickly. The main point from last time was to give you many theorems which on the first glance did had nothing to do with L2 invariance, and I will, during the coming two lectures, try to explain more or why these L2 methods will be very useful to prove these theorems. Remember, there was a theorem about efficiency, about the oil characteristic of groups, about oil characteristics and section curvature, about the question whether you can embed a complex group ring of a torsion-free group into a skew field, and so on. Here I just briefly recall the setup for the L2 Betti numbers. Remember what the idea was. We have the concept of a Betti number, which was very successful. We would like to go to a universal cover or to the covering with an G action and do something more sophisticated there to get an L2 version of the Betti numbers, which turns out to be very effective. So what was the general outline, roughly speaking? You started, say, with a finite CW complex. The next step is you look at the G covering, which could be the universal covering. Then we observe that the Sellar chain complex of X bar is a nice CG chain complex. So I made some comments why we would like to investigate the group ring as a topologist. And then we completed this to an L2 chain complex, which you may think algebraically as something like this, where you take the algebraic tensor product and remember the Hilbert space structure there. Then we are able to define the L2 cohomology as the following Hilbert space, which is just the kernel of the differential in this chain complex. But now notice, we divided out the image, actually the closure of the image, because we wanted to stay in the real arm of Hilbert spaces. And then that is the black box, which I will not explain anymore today. We have a notion of a Fanarmon dimension, whatever that is, but we're doing the same thing as we are used to in the classical situation. We apply an appropriate dimension function to our L2 homology. And this was what the Betti numbers were about. And as I said, I'm more interested now in the properties and what we can do with it. And therefore, for some time, actually, the definition will not play a role. So if you are not so happy with phenomenal algebras and Hilbert spaces, no problem for today. That doesn't mean in the long term run you have to learn this stuff. Okay, what are the main properties of Betti numbers? Suppose we have invented a new invariant, which is, let's say, parallel to some well-known stuff. You should remember what the old invariant is doing, and you hope that the new invariant has the same or nice properties, and of course, later you would like to do new things. And here are some properties of Betti numbers you all know. They are homotopy invariant, that means two finite CW complexes with a homotopy equivalence have the same Betti number. There's the Euler-Poincaré formula, which I emphasized a lot already yesterday. And we have, for instance, Poincaré duality, which tells you that the Betti numbers, of dual dimensions agree. So now what's the L2 version? Oh, now you see, very easy. You write everywhere up 2. There should be twiddles over the spaces. And then you get really the same things, but notice the Euler characteristic hasn't changed, right? So you still get the formula, and we'll emphasize it, that the Euler characteristic defined by counting cells downstairs is the alternating sum of the L2 Betti numbers. The proofs are different. This is unfortunately, which doesn't go by clicking. You can imagine this. You know, you have sometimes invent new ideas, but this is not our concern.
Is this in the second box, is that for any cover or just for the
I could put in any cover. Yeah, actually all these things would be for any cover. let's try, this was fun, so let's think about the Kunus formula, which you know, that you can compute Betti numbers in terms of the, of a product in terms of the Betti numbers of the factors. And all we all know what the zeros LDO Betti number is, I hope so. And recall that our spaces are all connected, therefore it's one. So now I will play the game again, but there are some changes. You see, Kunus formula, fine. But here the first interesting thing happened. The zeros Betti number is one over the group order of the fundamental group. And that means in particular, and I want to emphasize this, that the zeros LDO Betti number of a space whose fundamental group is infinite is zero. And as I told you already, the LDO Betti numbers are usual because they are very often zero, but also not too often. For instance, when you later want to run speculative sequence arguments, we love zeros in columns. And here, for instance, the zero column will always be trivial. We will see this later. There I should write otherwise the G.
Right.
So if you want to do it for coverings, it would be 1 over the order of G.
Got it. Okay.
Yeah. But at the moment, I think I will always use the universal cover. Take this as default.
Okay.
But now there's a new thing, you see, that hadn't arrived before. Namely, if you have finite coverings, so suppose you have a map from X to Y, which is a finite covering with D sheets, then the LDO Betti number of the total space is d times the LDO Betti number of the base space. And notice, this is not true for the ordinary Betti numbers. Here's an example. S1 covers itself, but the zeros Betti number, which we just have computed, is 1. This has already an interesting consequence. I will come to this later. This shows, for instance, that the LDO Betti numbers of the sphere S1 are trivial because S1 covers itself. And an equation that the number is d times itself is only available if the number itself was zero.
Is this related to this zero Betti number? Is like a sequence for the cover?
Yes, for instance, in this case, where pi is finite, I could compute upstairs, and then you see just the 1 over pi occurring. Yeah. So remember message from last time, if the group finite is finite, everything is trivial. Yes, here, that's the result. Suppose the fundamental group is finite, then we have just computed the Betti numbers of the universal cover divided by P, and everything is clear. But this was the uninteresting case, remember. And I mentioned already last time I computed explicitly why the L2 Betti numbers of a sphere were trivial, just a reminiscence. But I gave you now a better argument, which is without any work. Just use the fact that the sphere S1 covers itself, and therefore the LDO Betti numbers are zero. And these games you want to play, right? I don't want to go to the definition. I would like to pull out a nice property, and then it's just much, much more easier. Yeah, before I come to this, there is always a danger that you define something, you prove fantastic theorems, as I told last time, but everything is zero, and you are not surprised, right? And we should at least have one example that we compute all the LDO Betti numbers in a non-trivial case. And I would like to look at surfaces. So FG is now the orientable closed surface of G, and it's G bigger than 1. And I want to compute all LDO Betti numbers. And I will not go to universal cover, not write down the Laplace operator. I will do this just by the properties. So let's do this. So the genus is bigger than 1, so the fundamental group is infinity. Uh-huh, that was a zeros Betti number. Zero, very good. Poincaré duality, certainly the second Betti number is trivial. There can't be higher Betti numbers because this chain complex was two-dimensional, so we don't have to worry. And now we are done because we have still left with a nice Euler Poincaré formula, which I have now rewritten in the sense that I resolved B12. And here you see that the first Betti number must be 2g minus 2, and that is non-trivial sometimes. Right? Notice also that, of course, this last time, you see the Betti number is always non-negative, so the Euler characteristic is always non-positive. Remember, this was heading to the so-called Singer conjecture or the Hopf conjecture. So you see, this is a rather easy calculation. Here comes another very interesting thing. This is indeed interesting. I told you last time that if you can look at the case where the fundamental group is z to the d, everything simplifies drastically, and very often you get the right intuition for what should happen in general. And here's a very good point what happens here. So we start now with a connected CW complex. Let's say finite or finite type, doesn't matter. And the fundamental group should be ZD. And now I will try to do an algebraic expression for this. And of course, we know that the group ring, the complex group ring of CD, has a quotient field. Field of rational functions in D variables. No problem. And now I can compute the Al-Jabetti number purely algebraically by this expression. This is worthwhile to study. Maybe I write it down there so that you get sit in it. So we're looking at the homology. But now noticed, I'm looking at the homology of X twiddly with Z coefficients. Nothing L2, just the ordinary cohomology. Notice that on this, the complex group ring of Zn acts. And now I will just tensor with the skew field, or with the field, sorry, the actual field, with the quotient field. But for this, I have a nice dimension. Just take the dimension of this vector space. This is, by the way, obviously an integer. Yeah, the quotient field of the complex group ring. The complex group ring would be a Lorentz series, find the Lorentz series in n variables. But these are just quotients of rational functions in n variables. Okay. Yeah? Great. And the theorem is that this is the Al-Jabetti number. Pardon? The Betti number. Where have I got? L2 Betti number, yeah. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, sorry, yeah. The L2 Betti number. Now you see already that this is a much easier expression than I give you last time, where we go to the Hilbert modules and all the stuff. And also now you see why it could be that you make a daring conjecture that for torsion-free groups this is an integer. Here you see actually the reason why this could be true, and actually it's even confirmed in the case of a fundamental group being Z to the D. Okay, now comes something which I will skip. I told you at one point that when there are some technical things, I would like to reserve my time for something else. The message is there are Meyer-Vittori sequences. That is morally true, but not really true. But when you want to argue with them, you can do it. And this is spread over 10 slides, so you can imagine it's a little bit more complicated than that. But let me believe it. Yeah? Okay? So there are Meyer-Vittori sequences. You have a chance sometimes to cut something into pieces and make write down sequences. This dimension function is exact, but there are some drawbacks. It's not so easy. But I don't need it really, so. And if you're interested, look at the slides. By the way, if you go like with this speed, we will be done very quickly, but it's not the case. I would like to give you now some applications, and which should also answer questions we had raised last time in the beginning. So here's a nice result concerning S1 actions. Recall that the Al-Jabetti numbers of S1 are trivial. And actually more is going on. Suppose you have a connected compact manifold, smooth, let's say, it doesn't matter really, with an S1 action. And now comes the decisive condition. You may evaluate your S1 action at one point. So I'm looking at the orbit, so one point, which gives a map from S1 to the manifold. This gives you a map on the fundamental groups, and I would like this map to be injective. Yeah. It's called pi 1 injective. For instance, you can't have a fixed point. If you would have a fixed point, you would make this game at this fixed point, then you have the constant map from S1 to M, and this really can't be injective. And actually, this condition doesn't depend on the choice of the point X. So this question whether this is pi 1 injective is independent of the point X where you're taking the orbit. And then the conclusion is, yeah, M is L2 acyclic. I mean with this that the Al-Jabetti numbers of the universal cover are all trivial. the idea of the proof is indeed you take your manifold with an S1 action, then you can decompose it into pieces which look like S1 cross D2 or S1 cross a sphere. You play a Meyer-Witowicz argument, but the pieces S1 cross D2 and S1 cross S2 cover themselves. They have trivial adiabatic numbers, and we have the 5 lemma for zeros. If you have an exact sequence of 4 terms, 2 of them are zero, then the middle is also zero. Here's a mild complication. I didn't say the S1 action is free, but it doesn't really matter.
Sorry, say that again. You didn't assume that what?
The S1 action is free. So when I said I will postpone the pieces, I should have said the pieces look like S1 modulo an isotropic group. But as you know, S1 modulo a finite group looks like S1, right? So this is the reason why this works. So this is roughly the idea of proof. And here comes what's actually on my heart. I like to study spherical manifolds. And here the result becomes actually very interesting because I will have not to say much. Now look at a spherical manifold. A spherical recall means universal cover is contractible or all higher homotopy groups are trivial. And you look at it with a non-trivial S1 action. And I say an S1 action is called trivial is Z times X is X for all elements in the S1 and in the X. It's more, or you can say the whole manifold is the fixed point set. But this has already a dramatic consequence. First of all, this action has no fixed points. Secondly, this condition about the pi 1 inductivity is satisfied. And then you apply the theorem I had before. The adiabatic numbers are all zero, and the Euler characteristic of your manifold must be trivial. So just as sphericity makes more or less clear that either you have S1 action that kills all adiabatic numbers, or you have no action at all, then you may have an S1 action. Of course, the hard part regarding what I had before is to prove that this is automatically satisfied. I will not go through this. This goes back to an idea of Sullivan. Okay. Now back to properties of Betti numbers. So one of the theorems I liked most when I was a student was the Hodge-Rahm theorem, because it was combining algebraic topology in terms of Betti numbers with really analytic stuff. Here's the result. You're looking at a closed Riemannian manifold, and now you look at its space of harmonic forms. That means simply that those forms who vanish under the Laplace operator. And then integration defines an isomorphism of real vector spaces from the space of harmonic forms to the nth cohomology of M with real coefficients. In particular, it would tell you that if the nth Betti number is trivial, it means that the first cohomology with real coefficient vanishes. That means the space of harmonic forms is trivial. In other words, there is no harmonic form except the zero one. These are connections I personally like, and I will play with them. Another important interpretation is, and I'm going further to heat kernels, you can also define the L2 beta number in terms of an expression for the heat kernel, which I may copy here. We'll see later why. So the nth Betti number is this limit. T goes to infinity. You integrate over M, and here's a trace of the heat kernel evaluated on the diagonal. So what does the heat kernel do? So I like it to explain it like this. You have three variables for the heat kernel. So for the heat kernel, you have T, X, and Y. So what's the idea? T is the time. X is a place in your manifold where you start with, and Y is the place where you will end. And what are you doing? For instance, you make your manifold out of an iron model. You take a heat, hot needle, touch at the point X, that was my Dirac measure there. You wait T seconds and check on a point Y how much heat has been acquired there. So this is the idea. So what the heat kernel in something is doing, it explores the manifold because you let heat flow. Now this is very important. So I'm looking, when I look at Betti numbers, at large time behaviors. Small time behavior would be index theory. It would be local expression. That means local expressions are easier, and large time behavior is, of course, more complicated, but you can hope for more geometric information. I like to think of this like that I would say, I heat up my manifold, I let the heat travel along the manifold. It will reach a certain kind of equilibrium state after some time, and then I measure what I see, and that's a Betti number, roughly speaking. Of course, I'm integrating here, so I would put some heat everywhere and so on. So what does this have now to do with the L2 stuff? Of course, it would be nice if you could have some analog statements in the L2 setting. And again, you know what's coming. It's again possible. So let's look at more in more detail. Here you see harmonic forms on M. Now you see harmonic forms on M twiddle. But of course, now you have to invoke an L2 condition. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense. But otherwise, it's the same thing. You're looking at universal coverings. It's now a non-compact manifold anymore, so the analysis becomes harder. But I look at those harmonic forms which are square integrable. And then integration defines indeed a map from this L2 harmonic forms to the L2 cohomology, which turns out to be an isomorphism of the Hilbert modules. In particular, the dimension of this space is our L2 Betti number. And vice versa, if the L2 Betti number vanishes, this space vanishes, this space vanishes, so you will find no harmonic forms with a square integral on the universal covering if your L2 beta number is trivial. And the heat kernel expression is nearly the same, but you see one big difference. Everything is the same. Everything takes place on the universal covering now. So I'm looking at the heat kernel of the Laplace operator acting upstairs. But of course, I can not integrate over the manifold. I will integrate over a fundamental domain. It makes it finite. Just one nice interpretation. Suppose n is zero. So what then, by the way, my heat kernel description, of course, is for functions. It was not for forms. But the L2 Betti number is about functions. Now suppose that your universal cover is made of iron. It's very large. Is F infinite, and you have a fundamental domain here. You heat the fundamental domain up. You heat it up, let's say, 1 degree over the rest, and you wait. And what will you measure finally? No heat at all, because it goes everywhere. And if you look at the fundamental domain, it seems to be cold as it was before. That's the reason why the L2 Betti number is trivial if you have infinite fundamental group. And if the fundamental group is finite, at the fundamental domain is more or less P times explores the manifold. Heat will go everywhere. You have an equal distribution, so it must be 1 over pi. This is the reason how you can see how this really works. Of course, for forms, this is more complicated, right? But this intuition is quite nice. Okay, while I'm explaining the theorem, here comes our first non-trivial computation, which is not at all so trivial anymore. Namely, suppose you have a hyperbolic closed Riemannian manifold of dimension d. And then Dodgyuk could show that the L2 Betti numbers are zero, and there's only one possible exception if D is even. And this exception is an exception, so it's really positive in the middle dimension. Right. Make your reality check. I computed the L2 Betti numbers of surfaces, and notice a surface of genus 2 and higher is hyperbolic. And indeed, we got the formula 2g minus 2, and this is what you see. This is confirming this. And how does he prove this? So notice hyperbolic is this.
Is that middle dimension, is that something that's something to do with the volume like it does in?
No, no, no. The volume would be L2 torsion, which I will not touch here. Yeah. Okay, well, how do you prove this? In principle, we have everything ready. So recall M is hyperbolic if and only if it's universal covering is isometric to the standard hyperbolic space. Of course, the question on which M you are getting depends on the group you get it acting and how it acts. But now comes the interesting point. The L2 Betti number vanishes exactly if the space of harmonic form vanishes. And there I don't need a group. If I want to show that L2 beta numbers are trivial, I only have to show the space of harmonic L2 square integral function is zero. So it's a computation which I do once for the hyperbolic space, and then I'm done for all hyperbolic manifolds. That's very cool. And as you all know, the Poincaré ball, let's say, is very symmetric, the ball model. So in some sense, detecting whether you have an harmonic form is actually a one-dimensional problem. Because you look at it in polar coordinates, everything rotates. Now you write down a certain equation in one variable, and then you will figure out that you can solve it. It's not so hard. But then comes the square condition in, and this forces the L2 beta numbers are zero, except in the middle dimension. There's something very strange going on. In dual dimension, if this is L2 squareable, the other one can't. Only in the middle dimension, you get something which prevents you from something. It has to do with the hot star operator induces Poincaré duality. But it has to do that something is L2 squareable there, the dual won't. If you're not in the middle dimension, in the middle dimension, you can get something, and actually you do. By the way, this kind of phenomenon runs under Gromov's proportionality principle. So in some sense, if two manifolds have the same universal coverings, I'm not talking about the groups just as a space, they have proportional L2 beta numbers. This is more or less this game.
And it's just for hyperbolic?
This here, and it will be the conjecture says for any aspherical manifold. And if you have certain pinching conditions, Ballmann used showed that this is true. So, pardon? And Donnelly, you're right, exactly. Sorry, yeah. And for instance, that's all I'm saying. Now here comes the corollary. So suppose you have a hyperbolic manifold of dimension d, then if the dimension is even, we know that the order characteristic has this parity condition, which we have predicted by the Hopf conjecture, if you remember. So we have proven the Hopf conjecture now for hyperbolic manifolds. And also, I showed now that M can carry no trivial S1 action, at least in even dimensions, because the previous theorem said S1 action kills the Euler characteristic. But if we, in the even dimensional situation, we know the Euler characteristic is positive, it's a contradiction. In odd dimensional, you should have to work with the L2 torsion, which I can't, and then actually the L2 torsion is the volume of a hyperbolic manifold can't be zero. Yeah. So now I think you see for the first time how I could use L2 methods to prove results which were on the board yesterday, which doesn't seem to have the word L2 in it, right? So one was it's a hyperbolic manifold carries no S1 action, for instance, and the other one was about the Hopf conjecture, which we have now proved for hyperbolic manifolds. Okay, before coming to this, I would now like to go to dimension 3. Remember, I've done dimension 1, I've done dimension 2, and now we're coming to dimension 3. But now suppose I give you the task, please compute for a 3-manifold order beta numbers. Yeah, you would say the first one is 1, the third one is also 1, and you wouldn't say, yeah, the first one equals the second one. And then you would probably say, okay, take the fundamental group, make it abelian, you have it. But if you have some ideas about 3-manifolds, giving the fundamental group is more or less giving the whole manifold, right? So we would like to have a formula which says less, and I don't think you will come up with anything. So there is no, let's say, very nice formula how to compute beta numbers of 3-manifolds from very few data. This is completely different for 3-manifolds. This is a result of John Lott and myself. And let's look at this formula. So we look at this 3-manifold. And now you have to know that in dimension 3, you have a so-called prime decomposition. So you start with the manifold M. You can always write it as a connected sum of, let's say, R manifolds, which are prime. And prime means simply you can't compute or go further. So if you have a manifold is prime, if you compose it as n times n prime, one of these factors must be the sphere. So this is actually where the number R comes from. And I will assume that the fundamental group is infinite, because otherwise we know what to do. And here's the complete answer what the L2 Betti numbers are. So the first Betti number is R minus 1, that's this R occurring here. You subtract 1 over the fundamental groups of these pieces. You subtract the Euler characteristic. And now you count those boundary components, which are spheres. Here, you get no more or less the same formula. You only see that this term here has disappeared. And this is easy, right?
I thought
they were supposed to be symmetric. Okay,
I allow boundary.
So actually, I maybe didn't allow yesterday, but now today I allow boundary. And this is why the Euler characteristic comes in. And what should we think about this formula? I think you are convinced that everything is rational. And suppose your fundamental group is torsion-free. That means that all pi 1 of mj are torsion-free. But then either 1 over it is either 1 or 0. Then we get an integer. So we have computed, but by a pure computation, that for a 3-manifold, all L2 Betti numbers are integers if its fundamental group is torsion-free. And this is absolutely a non-trivial statement. I would like to give you an idea of the proof, or at least parts. Not that I'm so proud about the proof, but you see how much 3-manifolds here we're using. And this, anyway, may be useful to give a short reminder what we are doing there.
So you need here, if you are going to use the heat diagram,
yeah.
You need the boundary.
This is the theorem. Let me give you some ideas of the theorem. And then I will not go through all the proofs, but maybe I can ask you your question. So there's a way how you glue things together. That's the hard part will be a hyperbolic manifold with cusps. This is actually, but I will, let me first give you some idea. So first, because there was this prime decomposition, and because there's a connected sum, looks a little bit like a wedge. You can imagine with Meyerbeer rules, you can get the reduction from R factors to 1 factor. So I can assume a manifold is prime. Then there is the case S1 cross S2 that you should be able to do, right? And then this nice thing that any fundamental group, any 3-manifold with infinite fundamental group, which is not is prime but not S1 cross S2, is irreducible. It means more or less that, it means actually that any embedded sphere bounds an embedded ball. But now comes the so-called Jacob-Staelin decomposition. So I start with some manifold like that, irreducible, infinite fundamental group, and I have certain, of course, holes. It should be non-trivial. And now Jacob-Staelin and independently Johansen showed you can now kind of find a decomposition where you cut off tori. So what does a prime decomposition mean? The prime decomposition means I can bet in spheres into it, cut it open along the spheres, and then I have my prime factors. And what is the next? It's a tori. So I will find a very nice unique family of incompressible tori. So these are tori now, right? So T2, these are holes, T2s. And then we will chop this into pieces. And there's a maximal family of tori where you can do this. And then the Jacob-Staelin result says 1, 2, and 3 are ciphered. Or what is called utteroidal. A ciphered means actually you have a finite covering which looks like S1 cross over surface bundle. But notice, L2 Betti numbers are multiplicative on finite coverings, and S1 bundle has trivial L2 Betti numbers, so I know what the ciphered pieces contribute. They mean nothing. Utteroidal means that the fundamental group does not contain Z2 as a subgroup except for the possible boundary components. Right? So pi 1 can, of course, contain a Z2 coming from there, but it should contain no other Z2. Notice, a hyperbolic manifold can never contain a Z2 in its fundamental group. We are now Thurston, the generalization conjecture, says simply that utteroidal implies hyperbolic. You can imagine this gives you now a much, much better understanding of three manifolds, because we either have to do Seifert cases or hyperbolic cases. Now, the proof uses, first of all, Meyerbeer torus to reduce the question to pieces 1, t, or 3 individually. One I explained to you, but notice one was done by topology. But now how I take the other case, hyperbolic, and now comes into play that I'm looking at the heat kernel indeed. There I really have to look at the hyperbolic pieces. There's a complication that they have now a cusp, so it's not finite anymore, but still has finite volume. And then I have to analyze the heat kernel on the universal cover, make a certain calculation about really these traces. But since it's homogeneous, I have only two at one point. And then I get the answer that the hyperbolic pieces have just trivial L2 beta numbers. Here, just you have to make a computation. As I said, for me it was pretty hard because it has these cusps. You know, at this cusp you have a warp metric, but it's not really a product and so on. But the analysis just goes through. And now I come to the question, this was without boundary. Yeah, then you have to go, I have to use the other three big players in this dimension, namely the loop theorem and the sphere theorem. I will not go through it. So there are tricks that you double your manifold. Suppose you have a boundary, you can double it. If the boundary was a torus, more or less the L2 beta number is the sum of these. If the boundary was not a torus, it may be incompressible, then you do play other games, which I usually do. So it's unfortunately a pretty complicated, tricky proof, but it works. But I would like to show you this kind of way. This was quite nice for us, how we used this conjecture, and how you see how really L2 stuff is. You should know both sides, and if you know both sides, then you usually win, right? So I don't see there is any easy argument for the hyperbolic pieces, except I will come later to the theorem of Eigel. So this is not important for us today. Yeah, but so it means that if you have a three manifold, all these L2 beta numbers are trivial, and now I should start section talk 4, 5, 6. I won't. Because now you can define a secondary invariant called L2 torsion, which has many implications, but that is too much for this kind of presentation here. Okay, let's do another case, which is very interesting. It's a mapping tori. So notice Seifert pieces, there was an S1 bundle over a surface. I may turn it around. I have a bundle over S1, which essentially means that my manifold is a mapping torus. And here's the result. Which was a conjecture of Gromov, which tells you that if you have a mapping torus, then the L2 beta numbers vanish. And I can actually give you the full proof, which is amusing, and I will tell you why Gromov didn't find it, who is certainly more clever than me, but there was some reason why it didn't. So what's the proof? It's very easy. So I can go to a defeated covering. You see there, it looks like that I just iterate the automorphism. So up to homotopy, that's a de-sheeted covering. But then we know how the Betti numbers will change. I can compute the Betti numbers downstairs by the Betti numbers upstairs divided by D. Okay. Now look at the mapping torus. Well, it looks schematic like this. You take a cylinder and glue it to itself by some self-map. But now let's count cells. So I start with the X, which has, let's say, beta n X cells. And then the mapping torus, here's the formula for the cells. You get just as many as n cells in the mapping torus if you have n cells in X and n minus 1 cells, right? Because we have the one cell here gives you this cross, you get the old cell. Because you're gluing, you only have this formula. So now, now I have to remember that the Betti numbers were defined in terms of dimension of homology. You would certainly believe me if I'm saying that the Betti number of a chain complex is at most the number of generators of the bases. Or in other words, if you find the W complex, the Betti number should not be larger than the number of cells in this dimension. You play the same trick. So this Betti number is the dimension of this module, is the subquotient. Aha, so we have an upper bound for that. Very easy. Now we're putting things together. We have proven for all D that the nth Betti number of the torus is this number divided by D. And now you take the limit if D goes to infinity, and then this must be zero. Right. So later, John Nott asked Gromov, why didn't he found this proof? So then John Gromov gave a very interesting answer. He said, because I always think simplicially. Right? You see, when you have a simplicial complex and you go to the universal cover, you see the number of simplices is just multiplied by the index, so you get no information. The trick here was that the CW complex structure is much more efficient, and we get this bound, which is independent of the D. This is important, right? You know? And this is the reason why he didn't come up and made it into a conjecture. It's sometimes nice to be one of your heroes, right? Okay. Now is another thing I would like to advertise. I think also one of the biggest achievements of topology in the last years was Egel's theorem. Egel proved, roughly speaking, when you have a hyperbolic manifold, three-manifold, you can find a finite covering so that this is a bundle surface over S1. It was one of the conjectures of Thurston, where I think also even Thurston didn't believe in. And I remember that I told one of my graduate students 20 years ago that I will not realize or not be living anymore when the geometrization conjecture is proved and the virtual fibering conjecture. The conclusion is I lived longer than expected, but this is a really fantastic results. The sad news for topologists is, though, this was a topological statement. This is a topological statement. This was proved by Perelman by analysis, which he flow. And this is proved really by geometric group theory. There's not much topology left. But actually, if I would have had Egel available, I would have had no problems with the hyperbolic pieces, because Egel tells me these hyperbolic pieces are up to a finite covering mapping toroid. I have proven mapping toroids have trivial algebraic numbers. Go to find a covering, and you are done. And if I compare this argument with my argument when I did all the analysis, it's now much easier with Egel's result, which thus proves that Egel has a very extremely useful result. Okay, so let's see. That's good. Yeah, then I will now come to the Atiyah conjecture. And I'm now gearing towards the question whether the complex group ring embeds into a skew field. Remember, it was one of the things I found, I think, very interesting. So the question was, give me a torsion-free group, look at the complex group ring, is it contained in some skew field? Implications would be the zero-divisor conjecture and the idempotent conjecture. But now here comes the fundamental square of Atiyah into play. First of all, let me say what the Atiyah conjecture for a torsion-free group would say. So you start with a torsion-free finite presented group, and I will say that this group satisfies the Atiyah conjecture if for any closed Riemannian manifold with pi 1 m equals g, where for every Betti number that is an integer. Right? Notice we have proven the Atiyah conjecture for the g equals d to the d, because I told you that then the LTD Betti number was the dimension of a vector space over a skew field, which is definitely an integer. Think of all computations I've made. They all confirm this conjecture. Surfaces, three manifolds, and this is what I've done so far. And if you think about the Künneth formula, it looks also quite nice, because the Künneth formula will tell you if you have two manifolds, each of them has the Atiyah conjecture on its agenda, the product as well. Just look at the formula. So we would like to attack this. And we'll come back. But I want to remind you that the L to Betti number looks like a limit or fundamental domain of the trace of the heat kernel. And can you see that this is an integer? I think it's pretty surprising that this kind of rigidity is there. And I must admit that I'm really amazed that Atiyah already asked these good questions at that stage, shortly after he had invented these L2-beta numbers, and no computations were available. Not even the simplicial version I presented to you. So, extremely good insight. So, as I said, all my computations do support this conjecture. So, now comes the fundamental square. And, of course, these terms I have to explain. I will do it as much as I can. But now I will throw some words to you, unfortunately, but sometimes this is mathematics. I can't present it. So look at the left corner first, right? Do not look at the other corners, and you will be happy. That's the integral group ring, right? The right corner I tried to explain to you. A slick way of writing it was this huge algebra of bounded operators from L to G to itself, which are G equivariant. Now, in phenomena theory, you like to look at the so-called algebra of affiliated operators. I will not give the definition, but I could. But I will tell you maybe something which is nicer. You can also think of this algebra as the so-called O-localization of NG, where you invert all non-zero devices. So like I went to the quotient field of C of CD, if you remember. That means I have localized every element in the complex group ring, which is not zero. Of course, the phenomenal algebra has tons of zero devices. You should not invert them. You may want to do this, but then you kill the whole space. So you should only invert non-zero devices, and that you can do. And in algebra, there are various ways of doing a localization, and the over-localization is by far the nicest one. So you can really say that U of G comes from NG by a very nice algebraic localization process. So you invert elements. So we have this CG here, N of G, now here we have U of G, and now comes the ring D of G. For ring theory, this is routine, but of course not for somebody else. But let me give you the idea. So suppose I have a ring, as I have, which lies between two other rings. So I'm looking at a ring lying between ZG and UG. I call this ring division closed in this ring if the following is true. Suppose I have an element in there, and I would like to figure out where it is the unit. I only have to find a unit there, and automatically there was already a unit here. So this is very handy. And now you may look at all those rings which have this property and take the intersection. This is still a ring with this property and the smallest one. So the so-called division closure of CG in this ring is the smallest subring of U of G, called D of G, which contains this. And every element in D, which is a unit there, was a unit there. So if you like, there's something with units which allows you to find a new ring sitting in between. But it's very important you have went to the von Neumann algebra and then to the big algebra U of G. So far, so good. Again, let's check what we have done if G is finite. This is easy. Then as the grouping, of course, stays the same. Remember, the von Neumann algebra does nothing. Yeah, then I do nothing here. And this is just Q of G. More interesting, what happens if G is the integers, let's say? So I would like to reduce this square in this specific case to where G is Z. I could also write Z over D, but it's easy here. It's a group ring. We got a von Neumann algebra where the bounded functions on S1. That came out of Fourier analysis. And this localization process means simply you look at all functions on S1, right? And this, of course, is a localization because when I have a function which is non-zero, I can invert it. But the function from S1 to the complex numbers is a non-zero device exactly if it did up to measure zero, has no zero set. And this here, this D of G, is just thing we know. It's just
functions
measurable functions, yeah. And you identify if they have the same value except for a zero set. But this D of G is something very nice, which I mentioned before. It's just a quotient field of the Groth ring. So this is a field, right? And actually, I could raise this to the D's power. Then you would have the torus here, and you would have the torus there. So why is it important? There are two reasons now. Suppose that G is elementary amenable torsion-free. Then D of G itself would be just an over-localization. And this is used in three manifold theory a lot. For instance, Cochrane and Harvey give so-called non-commutative Alexander polynomials, and the key was that for such a group, you can get a certain skew field here, which turns out to be D of G by making over-localization. But meanwhile, we know that an over-localization of CG only exists if G is amenable. And you would like to, of course, to deal also with groups which are non-amenable. And then this kind of strategy to finding an over-localization cannot work, not at all. Now D of G is our replacement. So I will not talk about this, but we were able to extend a lot of things in three-manifold theory, which was refined to this over-localization now to arbitrary manifolds, three-manifolds, because we took the DG here. But this is not our concern today. Let us say interesting stuff. Remember, I mentioned that the Artier conjecture for torsion-free group means that for any closed Riemannian manifold with fundamental group G, all adiabatic numbers are integers. Or in other words, this integral is an integer. But now I have a purely algebraic statement. This is a skew field. And this is pretty amazing because these are completely different flavors of conjecture. You can now imagine that if this is a skew field, you will get the L2, the Artier conjecture. What would be the idea? Suppose you have a manifold, you look at chain complex there. We have to go here. But a matter of fact, you can also make the dimension calculation there. But you can also go this way around and make the dimension calculation here. But this would be a dimension over a skew field, which is an integer. Actually, that was what they have done if G is Z to the D exactly, just by writing down the formula. The same formula works, but of course, the proof in the case Z of D is elementary. I could give it to you, but I won't. This is, of course, you know, a big question. But you see now how different these flavors are if you compare this with that.
What you just explained almost sounds like a proof of the conjecture that if it's a skew field, then the Artier conjecture holds.
Yeah, the other way, the other implication is not so easy. Just the vanishing of the L2 beta numbers are always integers, it's not clear why D of G should be a skew field.
No, but it says, the conjecture says, if D of G is a skew field, then it satisfies the Artier conjecture, and you just get the argument.
I should have said more. I should have said the group satisfies the Artier conjecture if and only if DG is a skew field. Sorry, yeah, very good, yep. You see, yeah, another misprint, yeah. You're completely right, and I apologize for this. But this is an if and only if statement, what is surprising. Which really shows that you should maybe use more algebraic means to attack the Artier conjecture. I think using the analysis, which is good in many circumstances, has really not made any contribution to the Artier conjecture. It came all along this line. So let me, maybe it's worth by saying that. Here's an intermediate version of this. Suppose you have a matrix over the integral group ring. What's important over the integral group ring, not any matrix? Of course, it induces a map on L2. But it gives you an operator from L2 G of M to L2 G of N. And this dimension should be an integer. That's the same as requiring the Artier conjecture for closed manifolds. Now you would say, hey, come on, you told me that any real number can occur as the dimension of an Hilbert module. The problem is the matrix I would write down there would not come from the integral group ring. So this fact that our operators we may be looking at coming from the cellular chain complex will say everything comes from the matrix algebra over ZG, and there is some rigidity available. So I said this conjecture implies the embedding conjecture and the zero divisor conjecture. There's also a version of that here conjecture if I have a group with bound on the order of its finest subgroups. But if you drop the latter condition, then you can find actually any possible, you can find many, many numbers which are attributed numbers of three many, many sorts.
I have a question.
Yeah?
So would this, this proof be a skew field? Would that not require the thing you're working with as a manifold? It could be any CO2 complex?
There's nothing anymore. Just you can start with your group. And actually, this is also always this proof. I will give you an indication. You do algebraic case theory of the group rings, you do ring theory, but you forget the geometry completely.
So the manifold part is not
It's gone completely. I'm sorry for this because I like manifolds, but this is how it works. Okay. Just a brief idea what is known about the conjecture. Then, namely, Linnell proved the following. You look at a class of groups. Now comes the condition which contains all free groups. It's closed under extension with elementary amenable groups. Elementary amenable is nearly amenable, we will say it. And it's closed under quotients and under direct unions. And then every torsion free group in this class satisfies the Artier conjecture. So, in particular, free groups satisfy the Artier conjecture. And for instance, thanks to Egel, more or less any three manifold group does. That is important. Then using approximation techniques, which I may address next time a little bit, Thomas Schick could show that any group is residually, and now I'm saying finite, I'm saying in brackets, torsion-free elementary amenable. For the experts, I think it's clear what it means. And it also satisfies that here conjecture. And this is a rather large class of groups. By the way, a residual blah blah means that for any element you find a surjection to your group to a blah blah group, so that the element suffices, right? So now homework for you: classify all residually trivial groups. Okay, you got an A. You were the first one. Okay, very new result. This is due to Jaikin Zapirain and Lopez Alvarez. By the way, ring theorists. This is not an accident. They could show that any group which is locally indicable satisfies the Artier conjecture. Locally indicable means that every non-trivial finite generated subgroup has an epimorphism onto Z. These groups are very common, but it's not very easy to say a class of groups we love and we know that any element is locally indicable, except for one related groups. But this is a really large class of groups, and it was the last, I think there was no progress in Artier conjecture for at least 13 years, and this is now really, I view it as a kind of breakthrough. I would like to prove the Artier conjecture for all hyperbolic groups, for instance. That would be a goal, where you think, but this seems to be very difficult. So maybe I stop here. It fits.
Questions? Comments?
Is it elementary to see a free group on two generators and its complex group ring, or even its integral group ring? That's a subring of a division ring.
Yeah.
Would you mind repeating the question?
Yeah, sorry. The question was,
is the Z of F2 a subring of division?
Yeah. Because it satisfies the Artier conjecture and the Artier.
No. Elementary. Is there sort of a hands on way of saying.
Or whether I can give you this Q field in detail?
Yeah.
I think here, but that's all. So it's not so obvious that you write down some localization. No, it's not at all obvious. Already for a free group, you would not guess a candidate, I think. At least I know of no prominent candidate which gives you this. This is the reason why this is rather amazing. So the question is whether there are groups where you can find a nice embedding to the skew field. I fear not. Of course, there are some things with limits, and algebraic has some tricks, but not that you would say it's nice. Like I could embed in the abelian case into the skew field of rational functions. No, not so nice. No.
example, that Wolfgang is around till the end of this week, and he has office hours tomorrow from 2 to 3. So he is in 146. Well, let's thank Wolfgang again.
Thank you.